appreciate it. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Whenever that happens, I feel like ending at that moment. And you can always say it ended with a thunderous applause. It doesn't always end that way. But it's nice to be here. My colleague Kryn and I drove in from Atlanta this afternoon. It's not too often we are within driving distance of our hometown. This week it happens to be that. I was not far from home on Friday speaking to a group of 100 plus leaders from Islamic nations, and they were dealing with the whole area of the Arab Spring. Fascinating to hear some of them and present an apologetic and a challenge to them. And now here, I think, thus endeth the lesson is about it, because I don't know if I'm doing anything more within Atlanta's driving distance for the rest of the year. It's all great distance of the way. I do a big trek between Atlanta and the Orient quite often, and that long flight of 14 and a half hours from Atlanta to Seoul nonstop, celebrate a few birthdays along the way, and then get off and connect to wherever you're going. My wife would have been here too, but 3 months ago, I better get this right or I'll get slaughtered, we became grandparents for the first time. So I was thrilled to tell the world I'm now married to a grandmother. And in fact, his name is Jude. And nice to hear that verse quoted from the book of Jude. He's an amazing little boy, came in several weeks early. I was traveling for 7 weeks nonstop and was petrified that he would be born during the time I was on the road. And Kryn was with me, and I prayed every day. And I wasn't thinking of my daughter, I was just thinking of myself being there. I said, Lord, let it not happen while I'm gone. Let it not happen while I'm gone. The day we landed, it was 3:15 at Hartsfield. We'd come in from somewhere overseas, I forget where. Got home at 5:15. At 6:15, I got a telephone call that labor had set in. She was on her way to the hospital. And in good aeronautical nomenclature, at 7:47, she delivered the child. And I was at the airport at that time. So there's still peace in the family. And my daughter is quite thrilled that I was back. I've heard so much about this university, and it's a real honor to be here. Thank you for having me. I get terrified with audiences that expect so much. It was easier in the early days when nobody expected anything, and sometimes you precisely delivered that, and they never were disappointed. But somehow, with the years going by, when you get into print and on the air, expectations get too high for one's own good. So please bring that down several notches, and if God ministers to us, we'll all be grateful. And if not, he probably would have told you you should have been somewhere else tonight, and you just picked the wrong spot. Some of you have, I've no doubt, heard this, but it's so well done that it's worth repeating, and maybe for some the first time. The story is told of Holmes and Watson on a picnic trip, and they were out camping, and after a lot of liquid refreshment for the night, tucked away and were sound asleep. And in the middle of the night, Holmes woke up and looked up, and he looked at the stars, and he woke Watson up, and he said, "Look up, tell me what you see." And Watson says, "I see stars and stars and stars." He said, "What does that tell you, Watson?" He says, "It tells me that astronomically speaking, there are millions of galaxies and potentially billions of planets. Astrologically, it tells me that Saturn is in Leo. Orologically tells me that it's about 3:15 in the morning. Meteorologically tells me that tomorrow will probably be a beautiful day. And theologically tells me that God is sovereign and we are just a minute part of this great whole. Why, Holmes, what does it tell you?" He said, "Watson, you idiot, somebody has stolen our tent." Have you ever been overwhelmed by all the big words that some secularists use in order to tell us we're an accident? That we really are here by no design. that there is no purpose, no meaning, essentially, that you manufacture your own. And so Richard Dawkins and all shout louder and louder and louder to convince you that there's a wonder of it all, even though we're the ultimate product of primordial slime. And headed towards extinction, sort of oblivion, really. You know, you look at an enormous intellectual personality like Steve Jobs, and you think to yourself, if life is really worth nothing, what does it all really matter? Most of all, to the one who's spent his life or her life and ends up in extinction. Nothing beyond the grave. We are reduced to the end product of time plus matter plus chance. I find it fascinating because they still cannot eradicate this lunge within our hearts towards value and meaning. Even the whole problem of evil, which we wrestle with, the only reason we wrestle with it is because we assume value. We assume intrinsic worth, not extrinsic worth conveyed by some culture or some gathering of intellectuals. The only reason we even ask the problem of evil and pain and suffering is because we treat human life as intrinsically worthy. So you cannot even talk of purpose. Or you cannot even talk of evil or good without assuming purpose. They are hinged and linked to each other. And as I stand before you tonight, here we are, you know, towards the tail end of 2011. And if you were to stop an average student on a university campus and ask him the following questions, how do you define what it means to be human? I think the person would sort of be just offended by the question. Why do you have to even ask such a question? What is the definition? But they will write volumes on humanism. Ask them, what is the meaning of sexuality in its essential expressions? There are no answers. Ask them, what does it mean to have human life within the womb? There is no answer for them. Everything is contingent upon one's own pragmatic disposition and changes by the whims of culture and time. I think it was James Russell Lowell who wrote, he's the one who wrote, "Once to every man and nation comes a moment to decide in the strife of truth with falsehood for the good or evil side. With each choice God speaking to us offers them the bloom of light, then the man or nation chooses for the darkness or the light." He's a great American thinker. He also said this, "Truth forever on the scaffold, wrong forever on the throne, but the scaffold sways the future. And behind the dim unknown standeth God within the shadows, keeping watch above his own." Truth forever on the scaffold, wrong forever on the throne, but the scaffold sways the future. And behind the dim unknown standeth God within the shadows, keeping watch above his own. Alexander Solzhenitsyn years ago said these poignant words. Oftentimes, sophisticated intellectuals booed him when he uttered such thoughts. Here's what he said. "The West is on the verge of collapse, created by its own hands. Between good and evil, there is an irreconcilable contradiction. One cannot build one's national life without regard for this distinction. We, the oppressed people of Russia, watch with anguish the tragic enfeeblement of Europe. We offer you the experience of our suffering. We would like you to accept it without having to pay the monstrous price of death and slavery that we have paid. We would like you to accept it without having to pay the monstrous price of death and slavery that we have paid." Muggeridge, writing in the 70s, wrote, "It is difficult to resist the conclusion that 20th century man has decided to abolish himself. Tired of the struggle to be himself, he has created boredom out of his own affluence, impotence out of his own erotomania, and vulnerability out of his own strength. He himself blows the trumpet that brings the walls of his own cities crashing down until at last, having educated himself into imbecility, having drugged and polluted himself into stupefaction, he keels over a weary, battered old brontosaurus and becomes extinct. Now, there were voices in the 60s and 70s telling us to check our tickets to see where our philosophical assumptions were going to get us off. Francis Schaeffer was among them. When he wrote the book, Whatever Happened to the Human Race, he alerted us to what was coming. Because somewhere in that time in Western history, in America in particular, values were being jettisoned, absolutes were being mocked, and Chesterton's warning has come home to roost. He said, whenever you remove any fence, always pause long enough to ask the question, why was it put there in the first place? Whenever you remove any fence, always pause long enough to ask why it was put there in the first place. You know, the interesting thing about the scriptures is that it alerts us to these tough questions and gives us the points of reference for answers. If you were to go back into the Old and the New Testaments, you will find that the foundations for life and its definitions are right there, clearly written. I will just take three or four of them tonight and talk to you about what these foundations are meant to be for you and me individually, for us as a culture, and right from the global perspective, what it is that we ought to be looking to in order to establish firm pillars or a foundation on which life can be built. I think if you follow this along, just like any sermon, when you are preparing a talk, when it's all finished and it's all put together, you have to answer three or four questions before you shut that book and know you're ready now to talk about this subject. Every talk has to be evaluated by certain parameters and certain measurements. I have a grid of four questions that I raise for myself when I prepare a talk. Identification, translation, persuasion, and justification. Have you identified with your audience? Is it your thoughts within a language and concepts that they can ultimately hang on to? Is there something in there that will persuade them to connect with the ideas? Is there a justification for what you've just said and laid claim to? So you put everything down to a test. I want to present to you four tests for a foundation on which life must be designed and cultures and nations must follow along also. The first is this, the dimension of eternity. You must measure your choices by the dimension of eternity. It is interesting that the man who violated it so often is the one who reminded us that God has put eternity into our hearts, and yet we don't know the beginning from the end. But he's put that grid of the eternal within us. We yield to that when we ask ourselves the question, what is life really worth? What are you living for? We hark back to that when we talk about justice. The Greek philosopher said that justice was the firmest pillar of good government. In fact, Aristotle said justice was the essence of all ethics, just as injustice, he said, is the essence of all evil. To them, justice was very important. How do you come to definitions of justice if there is no eternal point of reference? Who becomes the judge? So whether it is the question of life's purpose, or whether it's a question of life's meaning, whether it's the essence of all ethical decisions on justice, and ultimately of all the question of relationships, what do relationships really boil down to? I said to my wife this morning before I left home, we'd received a letter of a friend much younger than ours who'd just been diagnosed with very serious cancer. Just a few weeks ago, one of my dear friends whom I happened to have met at Mount Paran Church of God when I was speaking there years ago under Paul Walker, the man I'm talking about is Nick Charles, who was the first sportscaster at CNN. Nick Charles was diagnosed with cancer a little over 20 months ago and died just a few weeks ago. He was only in his mid-60s. One story that came to our attention this week of somebody we know is of their 2-year-old child diagnosed with cancer, 2 years old. And all of these things weigh on our lives because relationships are meaningful. And so whether it's purpose and meaning, whether it's justice, whether it's relationships, the question of the eternal always haunts, and we always ask that question. I remember moving to Canada when I was just 20 years old, moved from New Delhi, which was my home city. And my father sent my older brother and me to Canada to sort of scout the land to see if the family could make a living out there. The economy was not doing well in India at that time. Some of its youngest minds were leaving its shores, and we were amongst them in 1966. I remember shortly thereafter, maybe 68 of Christmas, when the rest of my family had joined me, we were sitting in our small little townhouse in Toronto, watching something that had never been shown to the human eye before. When the Apollo astronauts were going round the dark side of the moon, and it was vouchsafed to them the glimpse of the earth rising over the horizon of the moon, draped in a beauteous mixture of blue and white against the black void of space, garlanded by the glistening light of the sun. It was awesome. Overwhelmed this man with awe. It was an unrehearsed response because it welled up within him. No poet, no philosopher, no historian could come to his aid with what he had just experienced. The only thing that seemed meaningful at that time was for him to go back to the first words of the Bible, "In the beginning, God." I remember sitting there with sort of chills felt in your body as these men thousands of miles away could only leverage one epithet to describe what they were going through: God, which to you and me represents every point of definition in the very person of our Holy Father, the Holy Trinity. In the beginning, God. You see, the eternal is too vast and too immense for you and me to comprehend. And yet, we talk about it again and again and again. C.S. Lewis, in a brilliant series of ideas linked together, talks about one day when he was standing in front of a flowering bush as a little boy with his brother. Listen to the sequence of his thinking. "There suddenly arose in me without warning, as if from a death not of years but of centuries, the memory of that earlier morning at the old house when my brother had brought his toy garden into the nursery. It is difficult to find words strong enough for the sensation which came over me. Milton's enormous bliss of Eden comes somewhere near it. It was a sensation of desire. But desire for what? Not certainly for a biscuit tin filled with moss, not even for my own past. But before I knew what I desired, the desire was gone. The whole glimpse was withdrawn. The world turned upside down, a commonplace only stirred by a longing for the longing that had just ceased. It had only taken a moment of time, and in a certain sense, everything else that ever happened to me was insignificant in comparison." But what does this mean when we have such thoughts, he says. Then he goes on to say this: "The books or the music in which we thought the beauty was located will betray us if we trust to them. It was not in them. It only came through them. And what came through them was longing. These things, the beauty, the memory of our own past, are good images of what we really desire. But if they are mistaken for the thing itself, they turn into dumb idols, breaking the hearts of their worshippers. For they are not the thing itself. They are only the scent of a flower we have not found, the echo of a tune we have not heard, news from a country we have not visited." And then he comes here with the clincher. He said, "You know, we are so little reconciled to time that we are even astonished at it. How he's grown," we exclaim. "How time flies," we say, as though the universal form of our experience were again and again a novelty. It is as strange as if a fish were repeatedly surprised at the wetness of water. And that would be strange indeed, unless, of course, the fish were destined one day to become a land animal. My, how he's grown. My, how time flies. We express surprise as if it's a novelty, though we experience it constantly. Constantly. He says it would be as surprising as if a fish were to be surprised at the wetness of water, unless, of course, it were destined one day to become a land animal. Time moves, time flies, and we yearn again and again and again for the eternal. You know, I was mentioning to you about Nick Charles, who passed away a few weeks ago. I knew Nick, and the first time I met him was at Church of God, I mentioned to you. He'd come to listen that morning, and he put his arm around me after that service was over, and he said, "Can I talk to you?" And then he says this to me. He said, "I've not been a good man. I've not been a good man." He said, "I've lived a very indulgent life, Ravi. He's a handsome-looking guy, you know, an icon on television, admired by many." And he told me, he said, "The truth is, I've not been a good man." He said, "Help me. Help me." We became good friends. We chatted. We talked. And the Lord worked in his life. He settled down and fell in love with a beautiful woman from CNN, also a producer. Her name was Corey. I had the privilege of uniting them in marriage. And after the wedding, a happy life had come to both of them. And a few years went by, he phoned me and he said, "Can I see you for a moment? I need to talk about something." So he and his wife invited me for lunch. I said, "Is everything okay?" He said, "We've got a problem. We need your help." I thought, oh my. So I went for lunch with sort of high degree of trepidation. And as he sat across the table, he said, "I have a question for you." I said, "What's that?" He said, "I'm much older than my wife, as you know, and she'd like to have a little baby. I don't want to become a father in my 60s. What do you say to me?" I said, "Nick, this is not fair." I said, "Getting you two married was okay as a minister." He said, I said, "Now you're asking some tough questions of me." He said, "No, give me your advice." I said, "I can't give you advice. I can just give you one statement." He said, "What is that?" I said, "One statement to you is this, Nick. If you deny her this great longing and joy in her heart, you will never be a totally fulfilled man." I said, "That's all I want to say to you." Not long after that, a lovely little girl was born. Her name is Giovanna. Well, a little over 2 years ago, he phoned me. He said, "I really need help now. I've been diagnosed with cancer of the bladder, and they're giving me no more than 20 months. We talked, and before he said, "You know, I've always wanted to live in Santa Fe, always." He said, "We're going to move. I know I'm not going to make it much, but I want to move there, and Corey's willing to go. I want to take our little girl." And it was a move they made. Before I began my 7-week trip some months ago, he asked if I could come and see him before I left because he didn't think he would make it through the 7 weeks. So my wife and I flew into Santa Fe. And I sat down next to him because his whole body was just trembling is a minor word. He was just agitated like that. And a nurse was there trying to inject something into his bloodstream to get him to settle down. And as he was about to calm down, he reached out, grabbed my hand, and he said, "Please pray for me." So I held his hand and started praying. As I was praying with him, his dog came over and nuzzled next to my leg there. His dog's name is Dante. My wife was standing to my left with her arm around Corey's little girl, just helplessly not knowing what was happening to her father. And then he looked at me and he said, "Can you stay long enough for dinner?" I said, "I'm not going to get out." He said, "No, I want to have dinner with you." We got him under control physically. And the four of us drove over for dinner. The poor guy, all the hair coloring from his face had gone. The hair was gone. And he told me this story. He said, "You know, Ravi, a few weeks ago I lay in bed and I said, 'Jesus, enough. Enough. I can't take this pain anymore. Please take me home tonight. I cannot handle this.'" He said, "My little girl is lying next to me, Corey next to her. And I said, 'Lord, You'll take care of her. You'll take care of Corey. I can't handle this anymore. He said, in the deadness of the night, Ravi, I promise you this. A light shone in the corner of my room. And a figure, just as I've always pictured Jesus, came over towards me, sat where you sat when you held my hand. He said, I promise you this happened. And he took my hand and he said, Nick, I will call you home, but not tonight. I'll call you home. The right time, not tonight. He said, you know, the world may laugh at me, the world may mock at me, but I'll tell you something, that's what has kept me going. One of the producers from CNN phoned me a few days later. I was in Singapore. It was late at night. He said, I'm doing a story on Nick Charles. He said, what do you make of this story he tells of the night that he had this vision? I said, where are you coming from in this? He said, I'm an atheist. I said, let me say something to you. His faith in God is not based on that solitary experience of that night. But it confirmed for him that which he already knew in his commitment and relationship to Christ. And Jesus will always meet you where you need to meet him the most, in the quietness of your life. And he will meet you to fulfill what it is you need to know at that time. But your faith goes beyond just that moment into something more sturdy and solid, the Word of God that abides forever and so on. I said, now let me ask you this. What do you think of Nick Charles? I said. He said, he's for real. I said, then take him at his word. This experience too. So is it. You know, I want you, when my father-in-law died, he was 85, struggled to the bitter end in fighting off the cancer as well. But the last two things he did, I was actually on the plane coming back. I'd spent quite a bit of time with him and I'd flown out for some meetings. And just before I got onto the plane, I spoke to him. He was struggling to speak. And then he had already gone into silence for days and then came back to speak a few things. And my wife is standing by his bedside along with her sisters and her mother. And the last two things he did, he opened his eyes, looked to the heavens and said this, amazing. Just amazing. And then he closed his eyes, looked at his wife of 60-some years, and he said, Jean, I love you. And he was gone. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to think of this. When we ultimately stand in the presence of God, no metaphors will help. People often say, what question are you going to ask him when you first see him? Nothing. What would terrify me is what questions he's going to ask me. The glory of the eternal. Everything we do in time must ultimately be measured by the value of the eternal. If you don't, you too get reduced to the pragmatist who relativizes everything with no absolutes of any kind. Eternity. When you find eternity, you realize at that point that you have defined existence. But you move beyond eternity to morality, in which you define essence. You have to understand what moral reasoning actually amounts to. This is the struggle of the skeptic, total struggle of the skeptic. They don't know how to define moral reasoning. They don't know. Many times I have used this illustration, and my colleague Grin often says, every time that you tell that story, I cringe, and I say, so do I. So do I. But I remember taking off from a country in one part of the world that I shall leave unnamed. It has in its the heart of its city a place called Snake Alley, where men come at the end of the day to satisfy whatever grotesque desire they have. And in order to do that, their mind is ravaged by a concoction of snake's blood and hard alcohol. They mix that together and just swallow it down into their system. And then they ask for whatever it is they want and it's provided for them. A woman from Holland who rescues children from the sex trafficking industry told me this story while she was flying out of that city. She said, last night I was in that area called Snake Alley and I rescued an 18-month-old baby girl being sexually molested by this man. Now, I was sitting in a plane when she told me this and I really thought I was going to be sick to my stomach. Explain to me, what has a man done to himself to come to that point? And you say the blood and the alcohol ravages the mind. What about the men who peddle this stuff? And I remember saying to a young Oxford scholar once, do you consider that evil? Because he was denying moral frameworks. I gave him two illustrations, and he just with his toe plays on the carpet, and then he looks at me and he says, you know what? I really wouldn't like to see that happen, but I can't honestly tell you that I think it is immoral. Sure. If that were your 18-month-old baby girl, you'll find a very accurate description for what happened. A man like that could end up becoming a professor and telling us someday there's no such thing as good or evil. You know what the problem is? Moral reasoning, if it only stays horizontally, is an argument between cultures and individuals and communities and people with no ontic, no transcendent point of reference. I've just finished the most difficult book I've ever written. I've called it Why Jesus, long subtitle. Rediscovering His Truth in an Age of Mass-Marketed Spirituality. I didn't come up with that subtitle. It was given to me. I had a simpler title. I just called it From Oprah to Chopra. They didn't like it. So I put it into a chapter heading. You know, when you research all these new spiritualities, you'd be amazed at what sophisticated people think is spiritual. Amazed at what sophisticated people think is spiritual. And so I say to you that when we are talking about moral reasoning, even mere spiritual terminology doesn't help. It has to be based ultimately on the absolute nature of an unchanging God. That's the only way we can make sense out of defining absolutes. An unchanging point of reference. And if you take the Ten Commandments, what is the one word that is captured in there? One word. Sacred. Your life is sacred. Your time is sacred. Your property is sacred. Your marriage is sacred. Your worship is sacred. Your word is sacred. And so is your neighbor's. You desacralize these things and evil comes in and relativism holds sway. You know, I was writing a book some years ago and used the Holocaust as an illustration. And I was doing some research on a man who tracked down Adolf Eichmann. The name of the man is Peter Malkin. And in a cloak and dagger operation, they got into the hinterland in Argentina and with their binoculars from a distance and high-tech equipment, watched this man every day. Eichmann had no idea. He was working at a Mercedes-Benz factory nearby. He would take a bus and come back. He didn't know he was being watched. And as he would get off the bus, they would watch him, watch his routine day after day after day. On a given day, the Mossad involved in all of this, hiding in that behind the bushes, as he was walking back with his briefcase, felled him, jabbed a needle into him, doped him up, put him into a car. If you have read the book, The House on Garibaldi Street, you'll know the rest of the story. For over 20 years, Peter Malkin, who spearheaded the whole thing, never broke his silence. Just a short while ago he died, but he broke his silence once. He said, I just want to tell you one thing of what happened. He said, I would watch Eichmann every day. And when I was on the train bringing him back, I looked at him. He said, the most scary thing to me was he looked like an ordinary human being. I couldn't bring myself to see how he had orchestrated the deaths of hundreds of thousands. And so I sat by him in his bunk in a train before I handed him over to the final authorities. I said, Mr. Eichmann, I watched you every day in Argentina. I saw you getting off the bus. I saw you walking, looking over your shoulder. I saw you getting home, unlocking the gate, looking over. I saw you unlocking your door, and a little boy was always waiting for you. I said, who's that boy? He said, he's my son. I said, how old is he? He's something like 8 or something. He said, Mr. Eichmann, I had an 8-year-old nephew whom you murdered. Can you tell me the difference between your boy and my nephew? He said, Eichmann was lying, look up to the ceiling, and with a glassy look, turned at him, looked at him and said, you know what? My son is not Jewish. Eichmann said, at that point, I had nothing to say to him. Nothing. He said, I went into my room, and I sobbed like a little baby. If you've seen the movie, The House on Garibaldi Street, you'll see that conversation take place. And Malcolm going back to his room and sobbing. Desacralize a person's ethnicity. Desacralize sexuality. Desacralize life. What do you get? Horizontal moral arguments with no transcendent point of reference. I am convinced that the reason Hollywood goes about with movies like the Da Vinci Code and The Last Temptation of Christ, do you know why? They wanted to knock off the causal argument. They wanted to knock off the design argument. The one argument they cannot knock off for the existence of God is the moral argument. What is the moral argument? Objective moral values only exist if God exists. Objective moral values do exist, therefore God exists. Very simply stated in a syllogism. Objective moral values only exist if God exists. Objective moral values do exist, therefore God exists. How do they knock that down? By making Jesus look just like themselves. Morality. You redefine essence. Hannah Arendt, in her book, The Trial of an Execution of Adolf Eichmann, in her last page has an incredible line. She talks about his speech that he gave on the way to the gallows, and she ends by saying this, it was the ultimate trivialization of evil. The ultimate trivialization of evil. Eternity, morality, thirdly and quickly, the dimension of accountability. The dimension of accountability. You know, this one always scares me because I've lived half of my life alone on the road. 90% of that time I don't travel alone. Now I have an associate who travels with me. But you're still alone quite a bit of the time. And you have to decide early in life if you're really going to be accountable to somebody greater than another human being or not. If you don't settle that, sooner or later somebody will come and trip you up. Sooner or later, somebody will come and trip you up. And you know what? It'll be either in sensuality or in material things or in power. One of these three will trip you up. If you don't settle in your heart that you are accountable before Almighty God. You know, there was an old question, only philosophers can think these up. If a tree falls in the jungle with nobody there to hear it, does it make a noise? I never in my lifetime thought of that question until I studied philosophy. If a tree falls in the jungle with nobody there to hear it, does it make a noise? Somebody responded. And, you know, questions like that are asked at the University of Florida. A man stood up. We've got it on video. He walks up to the microphone and he says, how do I know that I exist? He'll know very quickly if he exists if I don't answer him. Professor Nathan at the University of New York, when he was asked a question like that in his philosophy classroom, lowered his glasses and said, and who, shall I say, is asking? If a tree falls in the jungle with nobody there to hear it, there was a young man who thought God must find it exceedingly odd when he sees that the street continues to be when there's no one about in the quad. Young man, your astonishment's odd. I am always about in the quad. That's why this tree shall continue to be since observed by yours faithfully, God. The all-seeing, all-knowing. You know, it was an atheist from Johns Hopkins. He was a professor there. He committed suicide at the age of 75. Hobart Maurer, one-time president of the American Psychological Association, atheist, who wrote this. For several decades, we psychologists have looked upon the whole matter of sin and moral accountability as a great incubus and acclaimed our liberation from it as epoch-making. But at length, we've discovered that to be free in this sense from sin and to have the excuse of being sick rather than being sinful is to court the danger of also becoming lost. This danger is, I believe, betokened by the widespread interest in existentialism which we are presently witnessing. In becoming amoral, ethically neutral, and free, we have cut the very roots of our being, lost our deeper sense of selfhood and identity, and with neurotics themselves have found ourselves asking, who am I? What is my deepest destiny? What does living really mean? Fascinating that an atheist comes to an article in which he says, which he writes, when we lost the notion of sin, we now lost the definition for ourselves. I want you to listen to me very carefully before I move to my final thought. When I wrote the book, An Imaginary Conversation with Jesus and Oscar Wilde, it was part of a series of conversations. The one with Buddha was called The Lotus and the Cross. Jesus talks to Buddha. New Birth or Rebirth, Jesus talks to Krishna and a few others. And then the one on Oscar Wilde was Sense and Sensuality, Jesus talks to Oscar Wilde. You know, Wilde was driven by pleasure. Driven by pleasure. His whole life was pleasure writ large. And there he was in his 40s, dying in a little hotel room in Paris, which I visited when I wrote the book. His funeral was held in the same church that Blaise Pascal's funeral was. While he's lying on his deathbed, he looks at his lover, Robbie Ross, and he says to him, Robbie, I have a question for you. Did you ever love any one of those young boys for their own sake? Did you ever love one of those young boys for their own sake, Robbie? Question about love seeking the good of another from an atheist? Robbie says, no. How about you? Oscar Wilde said, no. Bring me a minister. Only Christ is not big enough to heal this heart of mine. You know what? Love is a supreme ethic. Truth is a supreme point of judgment. And if you lose either of these two, you lose God. You lose either of these two, you lose God. And his poem, The Ballad of Reading Jail, is one of the most beautiful pieces of poetry written, in which he talks about the woman with the alabaster ointment, who came and cast what she had out of her reprobate life and pouring it at the feet of the Lord. And because of his death, only the blood of Christ was big enough, was strong enough to cleanse, says Oscar Wilde. Accountability. I'm asking you tonight, have you recognized your accountability before God? It'll change your life, completely change your life, the day you recognize that's who you and I will ultimately stand before. And so, from existence to essence to conscience, we move to the last, beneficence, the dimension of charity. Dimension of charity. In one you have existence defined, in other you have essence defined, in the third you have beneficence defined, you have conscience defined, and in the last you have beneficence. You know, I go very much to the Middle Eastern countries and the Islamic countries. I was in Jakarta, Indonesia, just a few weeks ago. Corinne and I were there. On one night, you're dealing with the problem of evil. About 3,000 people show up and the gates have to be shut because the room is already full. On the last day, I had a dialogue with an Islamic scholar, Professor Kumaruddin. And the question under discussion is, why is there so much hate in religion? It's very hard to really be blunt at that point and ask him, where in the Quran it tells you to love your neighbor as yourself. Very hard to ask point blank. But I talked about the notion of love and the notion of truth. And as I bring this message to a close, I say to you, take a look at the Middle East today. Take a look at the Middle East today. 5,000 years of the logic of unforgiveness. 5,000 years in the history working out the logic of unforgiveness. And as I bring this message to a close, I want to funnel it down, especially to your students here. With all of your learning and all of the cerebral challenges, I want to draw your attention to something. If you have never understood what the cross of Jesus Christ means, you really have never understood the gospel. There's a massive book written, best-selling author. It's called Your Best Life Now. I went after page after page after page, great appeal to the modern mind, not one mention of the cross of Jesus Christ. You cannot have your best life now without an understanding of the atonement. I'll tell you that. I want to mention one little illustration and then close with the point I want to make. Last fall, we did an open forum at Yale. It was a Thursday night. And it was a message I was asked to give on the uniqueness of Jesus Christ. And I have to tell you, you go in terrified on the inside. I'm not putting you on. I've done this for many years, and in every speaking occasion, you're terrified. Because you know it's not in you, and you just hope and pray that God comes through. And on that Thursday night, the place is overflowing. People are sitting in the aisles, the doors are jammed, and they can't get in. And one of the members of the trustees from Yale happens to be sitting next to one of my colleagues at work. And he looked at him and he said, I don't understand it. You bring Tony Blair or some great figure from politics here on a Thursday night, they won't come to hear him. Anybody who's anybody comes here, they get tired of this stuff. What are they doing coming here on a Thursday night to listen to talk on the uniqueness of Jesus Christ? And my colleague looked at them and said, is it possible that you have left their souls empty? And I'll tell you, when I ended my talk there for the last 7 or 8 minutes, I spoke on the cross, and the audience sits in stunned silence because you put the links together for them. It's the most beautiful aspect of the Christian faith. And if you don't understand the cross, you really don't understand the gospel. And here's how I close. I had a 3-hour discussion with Sheikh Hussein, the leading Shiite cleric in Syria. An audience in front of us listening in, my interpreter between me and him. He was a very fine man, very gentle, a real gentleman. Always referred to me as Professor Zacharias, Professor Zacharias, and then he would speak in Arabic and the interpreter would translate. I would speak and he would. And on the last interaction, he leaned forward. I don't know if he had his pen or his glasses in his hand. And he said, you know, you have convinced me today of one thing. He said, maybe it's time for us as Muslims to stop asking the question, if Jesus died on the cross, and to start asking the question, why? I said, may I quote you on that, sir? He said, yes. Why? Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon himself the form of a servant. Being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also has exalted him and given to him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. I go to prepare a place for you, so that where I am you may be also. If it were not so, I would have told you. Eternity. Morality. Accountability. And charity. Existence. Essence. Conscience. And beneficence. Those are the pillars on which life must be defined. And then your life stands and meaning becomes a coherent thing, not just a fiat definition made in an ad hoc basis anytime it suits you to define something. You've been a wonderful audience, and I've probably gone way beyond what I should have. I very ceremoniously take out my watch. I don't know why I do that, but evidently it helps at least the movement of the wrist. I'm going to pray with you for a moment and then give you about 20 minutes for questions. May I pray with you? Heavenly Father, you are a God of mercy. You're a God who dwells in eternity and has addressed us in time. And Lord, I could feel constrained in my heart that somebody here has heard your voice tonight and wants to respond to you. And as you have spoken, may that voice truly cry out to you. And ladies and gentlemen, this is a better time to do it rather than wait till your questions are raised here. If God has spoken to you and you're dealing with him now and wish to make things right with him, either you don't know him and you say, Ravi, pray for me. I want to come to him tonight. Or you know him in name, but you know you're wandering a far way off and you want to set that right. Will you give me the privilege of praying for you? It's a matter between you and God. I ask you to give me the honor of praying for you. Just quietly slip your hand up, put it down. I'd like to pray with you as I close before we throw it open for time for your questions here. Just looking around this audience, just slip your hand up, put it down. Yes, ma'am, I see it. Yes, yes, God bless you. Right in the front here. God bless you. Thank you. Looking over the ground floor again. Maybe a moment. Yes, on my left. Thank you. The back. Thank you, sir. Am I right? Yes, thank you. Middle, thank you, sir. Looking at the balcony area, just slip it up. Yes, thank you. Thank you. God bless you at the back. Middle. Yes, several hands up there. And I know there are some behind me too. If God has spoken to you, just signal that and I will pray for you as we close. So I bring it to a close, giving you that chance. Father, for these hands that have been raised, I pray that your hand will reach down to them and gather them within the sound of your voice and the embrace of your love. Thank you for the privilege of being here tonight. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.